Good evening, everyone. Thank you all for being here. This is the one meeting a year that I get to start the meeting and preside over the first portion of it. Welcome to all of the folks that are here this evening. Tonight's the organizational meeting, along with the budget and a couple of other agenda items. And as soon as we get through the organizational portion of the meeting, the board will have a chair. So in the meantime, I get to serve in that capacity. So as we get started this evening, if you all would, Ms. Goodell, would you call the roll, please?
Mr. Anderson.
Here.
Ms. Dimmitt.
Here.
Ms. Downs.
Here.
Ms. Litton.
Here.
Mr. Reitinger.
Here.
Ms. Russell.
Here.
And Mr. Webb.
Here.
Thank you.
Great. Would you please join me for the Pledge of Allegiance?
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you. Seek a motion to adopt the agenda.
I move that we adopt the agenda.
Thank you, Mr. Webb. Second from anyone?
Second.
Second by Ms. Russell. All in favor?
Yes.
All opposed? Abstentions? Motion carries. Thank you. At this time, I will ask the board members, let me explain the process here just very quickly to everyone. I'm going to ask board members to place names in nomination for the board chair. After all of the nominations have been made, I'll take a roll call vote to identify each board member, naming the person for whom they are voting for. The nominee who receives the majority of the votes, which tonight would be four or more, will be elected. The roll call vote will be repeated until the chair is elected. The newly elected chair shall then preside over the election of the vice chair following that same procedure. So at this point in time, board members, I would open the floor to nominations for board chair. Mr. Webb.
Thank you, Dr. Noonan. I'd like to put the name of Greg Anderson into consideration for board chair.
Greg Anderson has been nominated. Any other nominations from the floor? All right, I will close nominations. Greg Anderson has been nominated as the chair of the Falls Church City School Board. We will now take a roll call vote, person by person. Ms. Goodell.
Yes, Ms. Dimmitt, you would name
the person. Name the person that you would
Greg
be voting
Greg Anderson.
For.
Thank you. Ms. Downs.
Greg Anderson.
Thank you. Ms. Litton.
Greg Anderson.
Thank you. Mr. Reitinger.
Abstain.
Ms. Russell?
Greg Anderson.
Thank you. Mr. Webb?
Greg Anderson.
Thank you. And Mr. Anderson?
Greg Anderson. Thank you.
Thank
Congratulations,
you.
Mr. Anderson. I will gladly turn the meeting over to you now, Chair Anderson.
Well, thank you, and I want to start very briefly by saying thank you to my fellow members for your trust, and I look forward to working with you in this new capacity for the next year. So, thank you. I will now, following the same process as we did for the chair election, I will now be following that process for a vice chair. So, I will ask board members to place in a nomination any names for the role of vice chair, and then after all nominations have been made, I'll declare nominations closed, and we'll have a roll call vote with each person naming the person for whom he or she is voting. And again, a nominee must receive a majority of the votes, which again is four tonight, to be elected. So we'll continue that process till we get to a vice chair election. So I will ask for any nominations.
I nominate Shauna Russell as vice chair of the school board.
Okay, Shauna Russell has been nominated. Are there any other nominations? Seeing none, we'll close nominations for vice chair, and I'll ask Ms. Goodell to take a vote, please.
Okay. Ms. Dimmitt?
Shauna Russell.
Thank you. Ms. Downs?
Shauna Russell.
Thank you. Ms. Litton?
Shauna Russell.
Thank you. Mr. Reitinger?
Stay.
Thank you. Ms. Russell? Thank you. Mr. Webb?
Shauna Russell.
Thank you. And Mr. Anderson?
Shauna Russell.
Thank you.
With that, thank you, Dr. Noonan. With that, Shauna Russell has been elected as vice chair of the school board. Congratulations. Thank you all. Moving on to item 2.03, I would seek a motion regarding date, time, and place for our regular school board meetings. Mr. Webb.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. I move that the Falls Church, the Falls Church School Board establish a schedule for regular meetings on the second Tuesday of each month beginning at 7 p.m. in the council chambers at City Hall, and establish a schedule of work sessions on the third Tuesday of each month beginning at 7 p.m. at the Central Office Conference Room in Falls Church, Virginia.
Thank you, Mr. Webb. Is there a second?
Second.
Thank you, Mr. Redinger. I'll just ask all those in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Aye. All those, anyone opposed? Any abstentions? Okay, motion passes. Thank you. Moving on to 2.04, appointment of the school board clerk. I would seek a relevant motion.
I move that the school board appoint Martha Goodell clerk of the school board beginning in January 2020.
Thank you, Ms. Linton. Is there a second? Thank you, Ms. Russell. All those in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Anyone opposed? Anyone abstaining? Okay. Thank you very much. And congratulations, Marty.
Thank you.
Moving on to item 2.05, there is a recommended action, and I would seek a motion for this action.
Chair.
Mr. Redding.
Be it resolved that under the provision of section 22.1122B of the Code of Virginia as amended, Peter Noonan, superintendent, is appointed agent, and Kristen Michael, chief operating officer, is appointed deputy agent to examine and approve claims and to sign warrants for the payment thereof. Be it further resolved that the agent and deputy agent shall furnish a surety bond conditioned upon the faithful performance and discharge of the duties assigned to each such official under section 22.1122B in the amount of $100,000, and the premium therefore shall be paid out of school board funds.
Thank you, Mr. Redinger. Is there a second?
Second.
Thank you, Ms. Linton. All those in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Any opposed or abstain? And we have a deputy member in the audience. Thank you. That was awesome.
All right, moving on then to
2.06, I would seek a motion relating to appointing a designee to attend school board meetings in the absence of the superintendent. Ms. Dimmick.
I move that the school board designate Chief Operating Officer Kristen Michael to attend school board meetings in the absence of the superintendent, effective through December 30, 2020.
Thank you. Is there a second?
Second.
Thank you, Ms. Russell. All those in favor? Aye.
Yes.
Aye.
Any opposed? Any abstentions? Okay. Thank you very much. And moving on then to the last item in our organizational section, 2.07, I would seek a motion relating to the School Board Code of Civility for 2020.
I move that the school board approve the adoption of the 2020 School Board Code of Civility as presented.
Thank you, Ms. Downs. Is there a second?
Second.
Thank you, Mr. Webb. All those in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Any opposition or abstention? Okay, motion passes. Thank you very much. And we'll move on to item 3.01, Spotlight Team FCC APS, and Dr. Noonan.
Thank you, Chair Anderson. Good evening, everybody. Again, it's a pleasure this evening to welcome Mr. Hills and Mr. George, Kenny G, affectionately known. So thank you for being here this evening. We have an opportunity to hear a little bit about some of the great work that is happening in the career and technical education side of the house at George Mason High School. This is something that has has really, I think, grown in a very special way in the last couple of years since Mr. George has come into our school. He really has taken great ownership of the program and has done a fantastic job working with our students. So this evening, the video recognizes his outstanding work as well as the rest of the team. So thank you all for being here.
When I think about the endless number of opportunities that our students are going to have in our new building in less than 365 days, this is something that's building for their future. We want students to create. We want students to be able to use everything that we're teaching them now, whether it's in their English class, in their science class, to kind of enhance and extend their learning opportunities. And I think this program is going to lend itself very nicely to us moving into the new building.
There was a lot of interest expressed, you know, and kind of water cooler chatting with other teachers, like, hey, I'd like to bring more, you know, kind of fabrication, 3D printing, computer-aided design into my curriculum as well, because there's opportunities to kind of engage my students. So I'll meet with a teacher in a different content area, like for example, math or science, and just kind of listen to like what they do. And then, you know, they send me back to my classroom with textbooks, and I spend a lot of time studying the different content areas in this building and finding out ways that I could kind of, you know, come into a particular part of a lesson or an entire unit and provide some sort of beneficial activity that aligns with what they're already doing. And the BC Calculus class with Jen Jason, she's done a unit where she looks at how you can use equations to solve for the volume of an object. So this is something that the students will demonstrate through a project-based assessment where they would historically build things out of foam core and other crafting materials. But with kind of the advancements of 3D printing and the accessibility to a lot of the stuff, you know, we had conversations about how we could kind of get students introduced to how a solid modeling application like Fusion 360 and 3D printing could be another mode of doing that for students that want to explore that field in a little greater depth.
Recognizing that the profile of a graduate requires students to have an exposure of CTE. What we're trying to do at the high school, which is also aligned with what we're doing at Mary Ellen Henderson, is to make sure that students are afforded every opportunity inside their class. Even if they're not taking a specific technology class, any class that they walk into, they're going to have that experience.
A connection between technology and biology is the neuron. And the neuron runs on electricity, has a lot of parts that do similar things to a circuit board, and Mr. George and I developed a plan for him to teach my class about how to wire a circuitry to mimic that of a neuron.
The opportunity for students to apply technology within any course that they're taking is there.
We'd like to welcome Mr. Hills and Mr. George up for any comments, questions, thoughts, or the like.
Thank you very much. Any comments or questions from the board? Mr. Rock.
First, thank you very much for what you do with the CTE program. How many students normally are taking advantage of that particular program at any given time during the year?
Between 100 and 125 students. However, part of what we've been doing this year is exploring how I can work with other teachers during planning periods that I have or other opportunities where the schedule allows me to bring classes into my room or go into another room, because that's the goal. Is there might be, you know, the engineering design classes, they might not fit in every student's schedule, but that doesn't mean that every student's not interested in what we do in those classes. So I'm trying to find a way to get to every student in the building, whether it's through an English class or a math class. But also to make those connections between what they do in core content areas, because you know, design thinking and kind of the use of technology, it is omnipresent right now and everything they'll do moving forward. So I want them to understand how to apply some of these things with a CTE lens.
Thanks. Any other questions? Ms. Litton.
At the beginning of the video, you guys showed the new school. So I'm just curious, how you guys think the new school might be helpful, and are there things you want to make sure are in the new school that will help what you do?
I think that's a great question. You know, I keep saying the opportunities are endless. When we think about some of the planning that really starts when they're in Mount Daniel and Thomas Jefferson and moving to Mary Ellen Henderson from there, we want to make sure that our programs are aligned. When we think about the new building, the focus on sustainability, renewable energy, when we think about the potential for the vivarium that we may have in our building, I mean, all of those are aligned to making sure that our students are kind of looking towards that career and technical education field. And so I think it's about really coming together as a division, which we've been doing. We actually have a meeting set up on February 10th to sit down with the middle school and kind of make sure that the programs are aligned. The matriculation is where a student who gets to the ninth grade level can really take a look at their interests in this particular field, and even as Mr. George mentioned, if they're not taking, let's say, that specific technology course, they're still going to be exposed. And this really was what this program was founded on. It was making sure that we were infusing CTE across all disciplines. We didn't want to say that those 110 students that Kenny teaches, they're going to be the only ones that are exposed to that content. So, you know, I know that's a roundabout way of kind of answering your question, because I think there are some bits and pieces that we need to smooth out. We need to take a look at the trends. But as we take a look at our data and where the interest lies for our students, you know, when you think about EMT, when you think about sports medicine, when you think about all the fields that fall under CTE, I mean, these are what our students are interested in. And I definitely see that trend moving in the direction and allowing our new building to kind of serve as that catalyst for what we're going to do in the future.
Are there any other questions from the board? Ms. Russell?
So I guess this is on. So question for Mr. George. Just getting back to the new high school, what, if anything, comes to mind that you're specifically most excited about with regard to the new school? And I guess what kinds of things would you like to see in there that you haven't, I guess, hasn't been discussed yet, or what's on your mind?
I mean, I'm excited about the new space on the fifth floor, and I'm excited that computer science is going to be adjacent to me. Right now, I don't have theater as an adjacency, and I work with Mr. Northrup on set design, but I think that I haven't really got to make that link necessarily with computer science. We've attempted, but, you know, a hallway is a universe in a high school sometimes, right? Like, so having that adjacency to some other spaces and a flexible lab, being adjacent to that and bringing other teachers up there, I'm excited about that. I'm excited about a new robust shop too. Like, I'm not gonna lie, a 4x4 CNC mill and a big laser cutter and all the nifty toys and gadgets are gonna be pretty excited. And honestly, that's part of why I'm trying to do this now, is it's gonna be an amazing space. And I don't want that space to be kind of allocated for 100 students. I think that there's got to be an opportunity to get more students up there. And I think the hook to that is seeing a project in another class, you know, executed on one of these pretty awesome new machines that's going to be making our building, you know, 21st century, you know, really kind of competitive design and engineering school. I think that's going to hook more students that maybe that won't get them into engineering, but it might just let them kind of see and succeed at something in a little different way than they would have otherwise done so.
So I know just firsthand that students love your class and just get a lot out of it, your design class, I guess what I'm talking about specifically. And I know it's a wide range of freshmen through seniors. So I'm just curious if you have engaged those students much yet in terms of what they'd like to see in the new school and what they're most looking forward to. It's
funny you say that. My Design 2 students project right now is design the makerspace, because we've been having a lot of talks about this, but I want to see what you guys want. Like, and part of that is develop your philosophies. Like, tell me what, don't just tell me what tools you want in there, but what would a makerspace, how would you use it as a student? Like, what would that be? So yeah, I'm trying to engage them since my first year here, which was 2018, I think, the year that the bond passed. Immediately my next project was like, what would the new high school look like? So I've been doing that, and that's on the, I guess that's coming around the bend for like one of the next projects we do. It's like, what does the new high school look like? And it's not going to be as exciting a project now because we know what it looks like. But the last 2 years, that's been a really fun project to engage the students in, is doing the high school design, giving them the RFP and say, all right, build your school, you know. And then last year we had the art. It was great. We had, StanTech in there talking to the students about the process. So that was a great CT connection.
Any other comments from the board? Otherwise, I know Dr. Noonan has one. Okay, Dr. Noonan?
I just wanted to picking up on the question from Ms. Litton and Ms. Russell, thank Mr. George also, because he has been in probably 20 meetings at this point about what the spaces are going to look like and the equipment, and has been an incredible advocate for his program and continues to sort of keep us honest about the things that need to be there. And between he and his partners that are going to be up on that fifth floor in the corner, that sort of CTE suite area, it's turning out to be something quite special. So I'm very confident that Mr. George and his team are going to continue doing great things going forward. So thanks.
Thank you.
Thanks, and I'll just like to say thanks for coming. And one of the things I'm personally excited about is to see what you may end up having with the development at the West End after the new school has been built, and what are the partnerships that can be done in the CTE space with the new businesses that will go into the new development. So thank you. Thank you very much. All right, we will now move on to section 4, recognitions and reports, and we've got 4.01, first, a recognition of our fall champions of character.
Thank you, Chairman Anderson. I'm going to actually invite Mr. Hills and the team to come on up and introduce their champions of character this evening. I see Brian Harris is here as well, so Brian, maybe it's you and not Mr. Hills, but this is a great opportunity to really recognize some extraordinary students for not only being great athletes and great students, but of great character as well. So I'll turn it over to you.
Absolutely. Members of the board, every season our coaches have the opportunity to nominate a champion of character for their team. These student athletes are folks who not only excel on the field, but are also leaders to their teammates off the field. They're all exceptional athletes, but they also have some specific character traits that our coaches try and instill in all of our athletes. And those character traits are integrity, respect, responsibility, sportsmanship, and servant leadership. And the six athletes that we have here are exceptional models of all of those traits. We have one that unfortunately isn't able to be here this evening. Jack Vagnon is our champion of character for golf. The other students that we have, Connor Plax is our champion of character for football. Joe Sevier is our girls cross country award winner. Ben Torilla is our boys cross country champion of character winner. Niariki Singhvi is our field hockey champion of character, and for volleyball, our award winner is Alexis Holowinski. And I'd like to actually give them all a few minutes to come up, introduce themselves, and share some of their season with you at this point.
So come on up to the podium, everybody, and tell us about yourself. Tell us your name, your sport, and tell us a little bit about the season.
I'm Emma Ward. I am on the George Mason cheer team. So this season, not only did we do sideline cheering at the football games, but we also attended several cheer competitions, and we placed fourth at districts, which allowed us to go to regionals, which happened for the first time in about 20 years, I think. So that was a huge accomplishment for our team and a goal that we set at the beginning of the season. With cheer, the main thing is trust, and everything that we accomplished wouldn't have been able to get done without the bonds that we create with our teammates and the trust that we have for each other and the hard work we put into it. Mason Cheer has given me my best friends and many opportunities that I'll have through high school and beyond. Another thing that we do with the cheer team is we get to make an impact in the community. We encourage younger students to come and do cheerleading. We do cheer clinics for the elementary school kids, which are a lot of fun because we get to see a lot of aspiring cheerleaders. And we do cheer club for the MEH students. We do fundraisers for the cheer program, and we also come to community events such as Run for the Schools, which is fun to go to also. So it was a really good season, and I'm excited for more. Thank you.
Hi there, my name is Joe Sevier, and I'm on the girls cross country team. I started running when I was a freshman and immediately saw just the kind, enthusiastic people on the team, and that's continued all 4 years. This year, we moved up a division as a school, and the team was nervous at the beginning of the year, but one of the main parts of cross country is teamwork. Even though it seems like an individual sport, you all have to work together to cheer each other on. It takes 80% of running is your mindset and staying positive, sticking with the person in front of you mainly, and just keeping on going. This year, we did amazing. So districts, we got first place. Regionals, we took third, and then we ended up getting fourth in state. It was a great season, and our coaches, Coach Buck, Coach Nguyen, and Coach Gogol, just pushed us along, and best sport in the world. Yeah, thank you.
Thank you.
Hi, my name is Connor Plax. I'm on the Mason football team, and thanks for having me. One of the things I love about football is that it's really team-oriented and takes a lot of teamwork to succeed. And I know you can say that about a lot of sports, but you really need all 11 players to be on the same page on the field to be successful. And with such a small program at Mason, it can sometimes be challenging to succeed. But what we lack in numbers, we excel in heart, courage, and friendships. You could tell every time that we stepped on the field that we were playing for one another, and the bonds that we created, I think, will continue for many years to come. And how close we were is reflected on our accomplishments this year. We were able to double our wins from last year and go to the playoffs with a 4-7 record, including a loss by 1 point and an upset in the fourth quarter that I think we should have won. But it was still good. We had 4 all-region players and 6 all-district players, which is much better than last year, where I think we had 2 all-district players. And I know with such great coaching staff, Mesa football will continue to excel and hopefully have a positive record going next year. Go Mason. Thank you.
Hi, I'm Benjamin Tarilla. I'm on the boys' cross-country team. This is my second year at Mason, and so my second year doing cross-country. And starting the year at time trials, I did not expect to get as far as I did, but with the encouragement that's just ever-present on the team, from the seniors especially, but everyone around me, I was encouraged to keep going. And I had the privilege this year of getting to know a bunch of new runners, particularly some of the freshmen and the eighth graders. We had a large number of eighth graders show up, much larger than last year. And particularly one eighth grader actually broke 19 minutes already at, in a 5K. So that was one of the highlights, I guess, to see that the potential that we have for the future. As Joe stated, we moved up to 3A, and we had 2 new coaches who really meshed well with the runners. They pushed us really hard to keep up with the competition, but I guess for me, I think we worked so hard that it wasn't as noticeable as it could have been, and we got all the way to states with a few close calls. At districts, I believe we got second, and at regionals, the same as the girls, we got third by a narrow margin, but it was worth it all the way, and we got there with the encouragement with all the seniors, and it's sad to be to see them go. I hope that I can continue to encourage some of the young runners to reach their potential in the future. Yeah, thank you.
Hi, I'm Alexis, and I'm a junior on the Mason volleyball team. And I've been on volleyball since eighth grade, and it's basically like a second family to me. But this season specifically was really strong for us, not just stat-wise, although we did go to regional semifinals, which we were excited about. But we have a relatively young team this year. We had no seniors, which is pretty uncommon, but we were able to navigate this new dynamic really well, and a lot of our returning players really stepped up. And we have such a supportive environment, both between players and also with our coaches. and this is definitely what's allowed us to flourish these past few years. We grew together really quickly and were pretty consistent throughout the whole season. And then during the few games that we did struggle or got in our heads, we always focused on having each player do what they could individually to lift up the person next to them and those on the bench. And the fact that we continued to put this into practice is definitely something I'm proud of and also what I think allowed us to be so successful. Thank you.
Hi, I'm Niharika, and I've been playing field hockey for 4 years. This year, I had the pleasure of also being a co-captain of the team, along with my two fellow seniors, and overall, the season was incredible. Like the other sports, we lost 4 great seniors, but we had amazing talent from both freshmen and sophomores, as well as juniors and seniors, and we had a relatively young team. But we pulled through, and we really bonded as a team, and along with the support of our wonderful two coaches, we were able to move on to regionals and eventually to state semifinals for the first time in the past 4 years. Overall, it was a fantastic experience, and I'm excited to see what the team will be doing in the future. Thank you.
And so I'd like to get us to go on the other side, or at least stand up here and take a picture and have you guys come forward so we can get a picture with all of you, if that's all right with you. Yeah. Congratulations, everyone, and thanks again. All right, we will move on to our next item, 4.02. We have a couple of school board resolutions, and I will go ahead and read them. We'll do each one at a time. And we have the occasion to honor two former school board members. Thank you both for being here. And I have the pleasure and the honor of being able to read the resolution, and then we'll take a picture, and then we'll do the other one, and then we'll take a picture, if that works for you guys. So, School Board Resolution 01-20. Whereas Mr. Justin Castillo was elected in May 2012, and since July 2012 served Falls Church City Schools with distinction as a Falls Church City School Board member, and whereas Mr. Castillo served as the chair of the Falls Church City School Board from January 2015 through January 2017, and whereas Mr. Castillo served as school board liaison to the Support Employee Advisory Committee, the Elementary and Middle School PTA Committees, Extended Daycare and Advisory Board, the ESOL and Gifted and Talented Advisory Committees, the Recreation and Parks Advisory Board, the FCCTV Cable Access Board, Tech Advisory Committee, and the BIE Subcommittee for Career and Tech Education and STEAM, providing excellent guidance and outstanding leadership, and whereas Mr. Castillo was instrumental in the selection and hiring of two superintendents to lead Falls Church City Schools, and whereas Mr. Castillo worked diligently and cooperatively with the general government for the renovation of Thomas Jefferson Elementary School and the opening of Jesse Thackeray Preschool, And whereas Mr. Castillo worked diligently and collaboratively, I can say that word, with general government in Fairfax County for the expansion and renovation of Mount Daniel Elementary School. And whereas Mr. Castillo served on the George Mason Mary Ellen Henderson Campus Steering Committee, the George Mason High School Mary Ellen Henderson Project Working Group, and the George Mason High School RFP Finalist Committee, working diligently and collaboratively with general government for the development and construction of the new George Mason High School. And whereas Mr. Castillo has demonstrated a commitment to ongoing professional development as a board member, including attendance at the Virginia School Boards Association Annual Convention, National School Boards Association Annual Conference, and VSBA workshops, webinars, and seminars on board governance. And whereas Mr. Castillo has worked tirelessly and collaboratively with the general government to develop fiscally responsible school budgets for the students and staff of Falls Church City. Now, therefore, be it proclaimed that the Falls Church City School Board extends its highest commendation and deepest appreciation to Mr. Justin Castillo for his leadership and commitment to students, staff, families, and the community of Falls Church City. And Mr. Castillo, I have a very nice little framed version that we would like to give you and get a picture with you if you want to come forward or and make any comments.
That looks really good.
Yeah. Yep. Come on down. Go on down there to get some the honor of reading a proclamation in honor of Ms. Erin Gill. So, School Board Resolution 02-20. Whereas Ms. Erin Gill was elected in November 2015 and since January 2016 served Falls Church City Schools with distinction as a Falls Church City Public School Board member. And whereas Ms. Gill served as the chair of the Falls Church City School Board from January through December 2019. And whereas Ms. Gill served as the school board liaison to the Professional Employee Advisory Committee, the Elementary PTA, the George Mason High School Athletic Boosters, the BIE Partnership Council, the Health and Wellness Advisory Committee, and the Virginia School Boards Association Delegate Assembly, providing excellent guidance and leadership. And whereas Ms. Gill was instrumental in the selection and hiring of the superintendent to lead Falls Church City Schools. And whereas Ms. Gill worked diligently and collaboratively with the general government in Fairfax County for the expansion and renovation at Mount Daniel Elementary School. And whereas Ms. Gill served on the George Mason Mary Ellen Henderson Campus Coordinating Committee and the George Mason High School RFP Finalist Committee, working diligently and collaboratively with the general government for the development and construction of the new George Mason High School. And whereas Ms. Gill has demonstrated a commitment to ongoing professional development as a board member, including attendance at the Virginia School Boards Association Annual Convention, the VSBA Capital Conference, and board development seminars. And whereas Ms. Gill served on the Budget and Finance Committee with the City Council and has worked tirelessly and collaboratively with the general government to develop fiscally responsible school budgets for the students and staff of Falls Church City. Now, therefore, be it proclaimed that the Falls Church City School Board extends its highest commendation and deepest appreciation to Ms. Erin Gill for her leadership and commitment to students, staff, families, and the community of Falls Church City. And we would like to give you a nicely framed version and take some pictures. Thank you, everyone. As someone observed, we are getting our exercise and steps in, going up and down to the well, as it were. So, all right, moving on now to public comments and requests, section 5.01. In accordance with School Board Bylaw 2.30, the time for each speaker is limited to 3 minutes. Additional written statements may be submitted to the clerk for dissemination to board members and for the record. Ms. Goodell, do we have any speaker slips? Okay, and did we receive any written comment at this point?
No, we have not.
Okay. Hearing no comments, we'll move on then now to section 6.01, our closed meeting. Dr. Noonan, 5-10 minutes, is that it?
Maybe less, and I might suggest rather than going all the way to the swallowtail room that perhaps we can go in the back and use the office back there, because it will be relatively short.
So we'll be back in probably about... Say again? Yeah, so we'll do that. So then we need to, I would like to entertain a motion to take us into a closed session. Ms. Russell.
Pursuant to the Virginia Freedom of Information Act, I move that the board convene a closed meeting for the following purpose: to discuss or consider the identified subject matter, personnel under section 2.2-3711A1, in particular, staff appointment, staff reassignment, staff resignation, staff retirement, staff performance, staff change in position, dependent care leave, long-term medical leave, child care leave requests, and leave of absence, and advisory committee appointments.
Second.
Thank you, Mr. Webb. All those in favor? Mr. Anderson?
Yes.
Ms. Dimmick?
Yes.
Ms. Downs?
Yes.
Ms. Litton?
Yes.
Mr. Reitinger?
Yes.
Ms. Russell?
Yes.
And Mr. Webb?
Yes.
Thank you.
Okay. Someone like to make a motion to bring us into close? Bring us into open, excuse me.
Mr. Chair, I move that we reconvene in open.
Thank you, Mr. Webb. Is there a second?
Second.
Thank you, Ms. Litton. All those in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Any opposition or abstention? No? All right. Moving on then would someone please certify the closed meeting? Ms. Litton.
Whereas the City of Falls Church, the Falls Church City School Board has convened a closed meeting on this date pursuant to an affirmative recorded vote and in accordance with the provisions of the Virginia Freedom of Information Act, and whereas Section 2.2-3711B of the Code of Virginia requires a certification of the School Board that such closed meeting was conducted in conformity with Virginia law, Now, therefore, be it resolved that the Falls Church City School Board hereby certifies that, to the best of each member's knowledge, only public business matters lawfully exempted from the open meeting requirement by Virginia law were discussed in the closed meeting to which the certification applies, and only such public business matters as were identified in the motion convening the closed meetings were heard, discussed, or considered.
Thank you, Ms. Linden. Is there a second?
Second.
Thank you, Ms. Downs.
And
Ms. Goodell?
I'll take the call. Mr. Anderson?
Yes.
Ms. Dimmick?
Yes.
Ms. Downs?
Yes.
Ms. Litton?
Aye.
Mr. Reitinger?
Yes.
Ms. Russell?
Yes.
And Mr. Webb?
Yes.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. We'll move on now to 8.02. Thank you for the reminder. You would think I'd have that by now. Thank you very much. Moving on to the consent agenda, I would seek unanimous consent to approve the consent agenda as presented. Seeing no objections, so ordered. Thank you. And now we will move on to our business and action and begin with Dr. Noonan's proposed FY21 budget presentation. Dr. Noonan.
Thank you, Chairman Anderson, Vice Chair Russell, members of the board, staff, and friends. Good evening. I'm presenting to you from a very different place than I normally do, maybe a little bit further than we're used to. But tonight is a very special night, and it's the night that the superintendent gets to present his proposed budget to the school board for consideration. So good evening and happy new year. Tonight, I do have the honor, the privilege, and the duty to present to you a needs-based budget for the City of Falls Church Schools. But before I begin the presentation this evening, there's a couple of people that I want to spend just a second in particular thanking for their incredible work. And first, I want to start with Kristen Michael, our Chief Operating Officer. Kristen has been integral in pulling together slides and data and information and has really made this presentation what it is. And right by her side, working incredibly hard as well, is our Director of Budget, Michelle Kopic. And Michelle, I want to thank you as well. In addition to Kristen and to Michelle, I want to take just a second to recognize our school leaders that are here this evening. We have an opportunity to welcome Tim Kasich, Matt Hills, and Valerie Hardy, as well as Rebecca Sharp, our Director of Special Education. We also have Mary Beth Connolly, who also serves as our Community and Communications Outreach Person, and Casey Mako is here. So welcome, Ms. Mako. We're really glad you're here. And with your kids, even. So thank you, girls, for coming. It is a pleasure to welcome them here as well, because they have also been integral in the development of the budget. This is not something that is coming to you in isolation. This is something that's coming to you with a lot of conversation behind it. Tonight's budget story, in my humble opinion, is a good one. FCCPS is positioned well to remain highly competitive with respect to employee compensation, and we have successfully eliminated items that were on last year's unfunded list, and also have an opportunity this year to refine our budgetary allocations based on our three big ideas and areas of emphasis, which are International Baccalaureate for All, a caring community and climate, and closing gaps. Tonight's budget that I present to you really is a representation of our values as a school system and as a staff. We are able tonight to present to you a balanced budget that not only meets the needs of our community, our students, and our employees, but it also builds upon the strong relationships we have with our city government partners as we continue through a phase in Falls Church that is essentially a blooming renaissance. Through good conversations and a partnership we've been in and working on to share costs, revenues in a way that are consistent with other jurisdictions, this year, just like last year's, we're able to navigate our budget within the City Council's budget guidance of 3.1%. The first slide of content that I'd like to share with you tonight is our foundation. This is our work around our vision and our mission here in the city of Falls Church. And if you'll indulge me for a second, because I think it's important, I'd like to just read our mission statement. And it says that Falls Church City Public Schools is a student-centered, innovative, and inclusive community of lifelong learners. We aspire to be the premier international baccalaureate school division. We strive to create a personalized environment that supports each child's unique needs and prepares every student to be a responsible, caring, and internationally minded citizen. Tonight's budget does those things. In addition to that, on this slide, what you'll see on the left are those characteristics and qualities of the learner profile that are associated with International Baccalaureate. And I was struck this evening as I was watching the video with Kenny George and the CTE program and thinking about how his work in CTE, along with English teachers, along with science teachers, and the integration of content really speaks to all of those profile traits. And tonight's budget, again, builds on those ideas. This is our placemat. This is what we would consider essentially our North Star. It is the document that we as leaders in the City of Falls Church Schools, to include teachers, directors, coordinators, paraprofessionals, and the like, look to determine what are those things that we are committed to. As a consequence of having this North Star, one of the things that we spend a lot of time doing is tying back to this document to make decisions that are strategic, that we know if we're successful in, we will continue to get better as a school system and remain one of the best school divisions in the Commonwealth of Virginia, and dare I say, one of the best around the country. So here you will see the qualities of IB for All, a caring community and closing the gap, and some of the pieces that fall under that. So some of the things you'll see is under IB for All, for example, is that collaborative teams are fostering approaches to learning and approaches to teaching. Or that every classroom in our schools are infused with IB instructional practices grounded in the model of inquiry. Under a caring community and culture, we continue to build positive relationships with the students we serve, the parents in our community partners and the like, that are safe and secure and bully-free. We focus on the social and emotional needs of our students and their health in our community. And under closing the gaps, one of the things that we're committed to is equity for all of our students, centering students that are on the margin back into the center, looking at multi-tiered systems of support so that we can support adequately those students that need extra time and support for learning who may not have gotten it the first time. This placemat essentially is backed up ultimately by the triennial plan. And this triennial plan is our strategic plan that incorporates many of the strategies and outcome goals that we have that are associated with our triennial plan. So that essentially sits on top of this. So if the community or staff or the board were interested in seeing very specific actions that we're taking to meet those three big ideas within the placemat, this would be the place to go to look at those. So we are a successful system. One measure, and I'll repeat that, one measure of success of a school system in the Commonwealth of Virginia are our pass rates on the standards of learning assessments. It is something that we have to pay attention to, because if we don't, what doesn't get paid attention to might not get done. And so it's very important to us to pay attention to these. And this year, as I've stated to the board before and to our community, for the first time in 4 years, we achieved a 90% pass rate in all of the assessed areas. And something that we're very, very proud of. Some other measures of success that I think are important to pay attention to as well are, how are our students college and career ready? And these are metrics that come out from the state of Virginia, the Commonwealth of Virginia's Department of Education. And here, this chart shows the students on the left-hand side are Falls Church City Public Schools. The students on the right-hand side are the students across the state. The dark blue portion of the pie chart represents the advanced diploma. So in the City of Falls Church Schools, students who are leaving George Mason High School at a 72% rate are leaving with the advanced diploma, which means that they're completing a sequence of courses that have prepared them much better for a college and career experience than if they had gotten the standard diploma. They've seen a sequence of mathematics all the way through. They've seen a sequence of history, English, all the way through, and the like. The light blue is the standard or other diplomas. That doesn't suggest that students aren't college or career ready if they get the standard diploma. They just haven't completed some of the course sequences that the students that have achieved the advanced diploma have. And then the purple in the chart are GED certificates and other non-graduates. I share this because it's a really interesting contrast to me as you look at the City of Falls Church schools versus the state. On the state side, you'll see 51.5% of the students are earning the advanced diploma, while 40% are earning the standard diploma. The purple area that's represented on the state is a small sliver like ours, but in addition to the state pie, you will see an orange or red section, and that's 5.6%, and that represents the dropouts. You won't notice any of that color on our chart, and it's a real testament to the extraordinary work that all of our teachers do from pre-K to 12 to prepare our kids to walk across the stage at Constitution Hall in June and get their diploma from George Mason High School. Another measure of success for us is student achievement in the International Baccalaureate program. And the big takeaway that I hope you will glean from this slide when we talk about IB for All is that if you attend the City of Falls Church schools between the grades of K and 10, you are in the International Baccalaureate program. There's no way around it. We have the primary years program at our elementary schools. We have the middle years program, which runs from grade 6 to grade 10 between the middle and the high school. And at that point, students have an option to continue taking IB courses, and they can take a series of courses in combination to try and achieve the International Baccalaureate diploma, or students can simply take a couple of courses that they like to take that they have interest in within the area of IB. That being said, one of the things you'll note on the left-hand side within the data is that 86% of our junior class and 87% of our senior class last year enrolled in at least one International Baccalaureate program. In 2018, we had 47 diploma candidates and 40 students were awarded the diploma. And in 2019, 50 diploma candidates and 47 diplomas were awarded. Again, I want to also reinforce a comment that I made earlier, and that is that while the International Baccalaureate courses have the IB moniker, whether it's an IB course or not, the approaches to learning and the approaches of teaching to teaching are infused in every single class across the system here in the City of Falls Church. Some other areas of recognition which I think are worthy of mention. At the secondary level, we have the National World Strides Music Festival. We've been successful in the IB Art Exhibition. Give Day, the Science Fair, and Husky Awards continue to be big events for us across the system. Tonight, we celebrated our Champions of Character, which are not only students that are academically performing, not only performing on the field, but they're also performing beyond that and being really of great quality within our community. We have 1418, that's all we need to say, in the City of Falls Church. 1418, of course, is our robotics team. It's a number that everybody knows, and they are super successful again this year. And our Cyber Patriots team continue to participate and move forward in the state rounds around cybersecurity challenges. Some other recognitions that didn't make this that I want to just mention that are of note recently, the Virginia High School League recognized our theater students as state champions. Some of you saw the show last night at Creative Cauldron. And then our mock trial team also were VHSL champions this year as well. At the elementary level, we continue to be incredibly competitive in Word Masters challenges, Math Olympiad, MathCon, and Odyssey of the Mind. These are not only local competitions, they're regional, national, and international competitions. We have well-rounded, strong students here in the City of Falls Church schools. We are, as Mr. Hills said earlier in his presentation, T-minus 365 days, but it's more like T-minus 355 days, to the opening of the new George Mason High School on the site right next to the current George Mason. This is a huge project for the schools and an incredible undertaking for the community. So we've built this budget this year, again recognizing that there are a lot of things happening in our community that we need to be thoughtful about, cognizant about, but also at the same time recognizing that we have needs as a school system and need to work within what we have to be able to meet those needs. So keeping in mind that we are working through George Mason High School was at the top of our mind as we were developing this budget. I want to talk just briefly about enrollment projections in the process. The school board is aware of this, but I want to make sure the community is as well. Projections for the school system are prepared each year by the Cooper Center at the University of Virginia. The Cooper Center is a well-revered center for statistics to the extent that they also are used by the state of Virginia to identify how tax revenues are dispersed to all school all school divisions. The data that we look at are twofold, or that they look at and take into account as they're doing their projections. The first is they're looking at birth data. And the second is they're looking at cohort data and membership counts from the prior year. The one thing they're not looking at, and I think it's important to note to the school board this evening and also for the community, is that they don't look at projected growth in the community. For example, we are currently in the process of development of Founders Row here in the city of Falls Church. We're not exactly sure what's going to happen at the corner of Washington and Broad. There's going to be some development there. We know that there's going to be a lot of development up next to the high school. Those numbers are not calculated into the projections by Weldon Cooper. So I say that only to put it on your radar and to perhaps even foreshadow for you what enrollment may look like as we continue moving forward, making our enrollment projections. This is an interesting slide that is new this year, but I think graphically it represents some trend. I think there's no way around it. It goes up. And what we see here is that Weldon Cooper has done a pretty nice job of projecting. And we did take a dip. This started in 2001. It goes out to 2020, 2021 projections. We did take a dip after 2017, 2018, but we are seeing, again, enrollment beginning to rise. And I only anticipate that that will go up from where we are now. So here's the projections by grade for next year. So as I orient you to this chart, what I would start with is that across the top are FY17 actual, 18 actual, 19 actual, and 20 actual. Those are the actual enrollments. And then we look at the fiscal year 21 projection and how that change looks. So you'll begin to see the delta on the far right-hand side. And then working down is by school. I think this chart is particularly useful, not necessarily for budget conversations, but for our school leadership to see where students are moving by grade. So I pointed out, for example, yesterday in one of our meetings that Mount Daniel, for example,'s projection for 2021 is 168 kindergartners. This year, our actual enrollment in kindergarten was 181. If the projection holds, we'll be 13 fewer in kindergarten. So where are those 13 going? Well, they're going one grade up. So if you look at this coming 21 projection, we're looking at 187 first graders compared to 172 the prior year, so looking at growing by 15. The interesting number that I think we've called attention to for a number of years now is that sixth grade class at Mary Ellen Henderson that moved up last year. This year, our actual enrollment was 236, and next year we're anticipating that that sixth grade class will be 171, which means that that class will lose 65 students, but our seventh grade group will grow by 41. And they're growing by 41 because their starting point was fewer than the previous year. The big nugget here for the board and for the community to recognize is that it looks as though we're going to grow by a total of 37 students across the division this year, if the projections hold. And it will be across all grade levels. So one of the things you won't see in this budget this year are any additional teaching positions in our schools. And we feel like we will be able to absorb those 37 students while maintaining the class sizes that we are committed to as a school division. These two pie charts are traditional. This is where is the money coming from and how are we spending the money. So what you'll see here is the 2021 proposed budget pie charts. On the left-hand side, you'll see that the local transfer from the general government and city council represents 81.7% of our pie. And the state aid this year will represent 14.7% of our pie, and it gets smaller from there. We have a small amount of money that comes from the federal government, 1.1% for federal programs. That number, by the way, is shrinking from last year, so we are seeing less dollars coming from the federal government, some fees, and then some beginning balance. But the right-hand side shows where we spend the money. And this is a common theme that you've heard me talk about for the last couple of years. And that is when you take the two largest areas of that pie together, the salary and the benefits, it's about 86% of the pie in the City of Falls Church Schools is spent on salaries and benefits. Those are our people. So when we hear questions about can we tighten our belt or can we get lean, the only way that we can really fundamentally shift the game in terms of a budget is for us to cut people. It's very difficult to get into contracted services. We can take a little bit here and there from materials and supplies, but if we really want to make inroads in cutting a budget, the place we have to go is by cutting people, which means that we're taking staff out of our schools more than likely. So it's very difficult for us as a school system to really tighten our belts. What we can do is we can become more efficient and we can look at where there are opportunities. And we did that last year. So you may recall we cut 5 positions across the system last year. We got very lean, we got very efficient, and in the end, we're able to make some adjustments in our budget and be able to compensate our staff because of that. Again, this year, I don't see that we're gonna need to make those same cuts that we did last year, based on the transfer amount that we're receiving and some state aid. So the guidance on December 9th of last year was 3.1, which represents organic growth. The funding share of 3.1% to the city schools is $1.34 million. So that becomes our starting point for building our budget with the transfer from the general government. We anticipate, just like we have in the past, that through this methodology, if there are additional revenues that fall out at the end of the budget cycle or at the end of the year, that those revenues would be shared 50-50. And that is, in some ways, a handshake deal that we have made with the general government. So that means that the entire transfer to the city schools from the general government this coming year at 3.1% represents $44,596,706. The big story for us this year is state revenue. Based on the governor's proposed budget that was released on December 19th, state revenue in the City of Falls Church Schools will represent 14.7% of our budget. It's a greater percentage than it has been in the past, and here's the reason why. This year, like they do every 2 years, the state re-benchmarks. In other words, they go back, they look at the standards of quality, they look at the amount of money that is funded through the state government to pay for those things that are in the standards of quality, and they continue to fund those. The state has yet to fully fund the standards of quality, but they are working hard to make amends around that. This past re-benchmarking, the state also had an opportunity to make some changes to some ratios. And because they made some changes to some of the ratios that happen in the schools, so for example, school council ratios dropped, some other ratios dropped, the state then put more money into the standards of quality, and that meant that more money was going to come to school divisions. We already exceed what the new re-benchmarked ratios are for the positions that are part of the state's SOQ now, which means that the dollars that we're receiving become much more flexible because we're already meeting the revised benchmark that the state has given us. So what that means for us with respect to state aid is that state aid is going to come in this year at about $4.9 million. That's an increase of $712,000 through state aid. And sales tax is going to be $3.1 million roughly. And it's projected to increase at about $253,000, or about 17.1%. Again, this is the governor's budget that we're utilizing. We feel a little bit confident, a little bit more confident than we typically do, because it is a Democratic governor, it's a Democratic House, it's a Democratic Senate, and there still is roughly $200 million for the legislature to look at and to be able to utilize. So feeling quite confident in many of these numbers. So when you take those in combination, that gives us about $940,000 additional money in the school system that we didn't have previously to work with within our budget. So our projected revenues, again, for 2021, as I indicated before, are a combination of our local revenue, state revenue, federal revenue, and then some beginning balance. And we don't anticipate changing our beginning balance. It will remain at about $450,000. And that is essentially like a rainy day fund that we keep, just like we would in our homes, just in case something happens. But what's interesting under the federal revenue is you will see that there's a projected total of about $573,000 coming from the federal government. That is a decrease in an award for our federal grants program by about $12,000, which is disappointing. So it leads us now to what are our priorities as a division. After speaking with the board and talking a little bit about budget priorities, after speaking with principals, after speaking with staff, and multiple groups throughout the community, the number one thing that came up as a priority across the system has been and continues to be compensation for the system. So tonight, what I'm proposing as my budget is that we provide a step increase for all of our eligible employees across the system. This is the deal that we make with our staff to say when you get into a step in grade system that every year we're going to advance your pay by a certain amount. This step increase for us this year represents about $971,000 and is on average about a 2.7% increase, a percent increase for every employee that would get a step. The other piece of the proposal around compensation is looking at a cost of living adjustment, and I'm proposing a 1% cost of living adjustment in addition to the step. So not only will people move to the next step that are eligible, but it also will help us grow and remain competitive within the salary scale, because if we don't add money into the salary scale through a market scale adjustment, the scale stays the same and we begin to lose competitiveness in the marketplace, and that's really important to us. So these are needs, and so I think about needs, wants, and mandatory when we think about a budget. This is a need for us. So in terms of presenting a needs-based budget, we need to be competitive and we need to compensate our employees. The next slide represents a mandatory. This is a non-negotiable for us. And by the way, and I'm going to back up just for a second, because I do want to also do the quick math on this slide. That's about $1.37 million, which is about the amount of the transfer that we would get from the general government. So thinking about employee compensation, that roughly eats up the entire transfer from the locality. The mandatory requirements that we have are our health insurance rates are rising this year. We're anticipating a 10% rate increase for both the employer and the employee portion of that rate. We do participate with the general government. It's a nice efficiency that we have, and we're part of the same pool. And they are also calculating about a 10% increase as well. In addition to that, the Virginia retirement system cost is going up by about $270,000. The retirement rate is increasing from 16.68% up to 17.83%. And that is to take care of some concerns that the actuaries have with the VRS system. And lastly, the Virginia retirement system's life insurance policy expenditures are going to go up by a very small amount, but about $1,700 from 1.31% to 1.33%. So those are mandatory. So we have wants mandatory and or needs mandatory. And here is another set that I would characterize as a need. And these become the 2021 investments on our goals and in our future. So the total amount of these requests that we've prepared for you tonight is $540,734. I'm going to work sort of from the middle and then to the side. One of the things that I want to make sure that I call your attention to in the community and as the board is that we have aligned, again, all of our desired budgetary requests with those three big ideas that are in the placemat. So IB for all, closing gaps, caring community, closing gaps, caring community and culture, and caring community and culture. There are some that are for the secondary schools, there are some that are system-wide, and there's one that is for preschool only. So let me start and work down the list on the left-hand side. The first request that we have is for a second International Baccalaureate Middle Years Program Coordinator. We have one at the high school who manages the DP program, so we have a DP coordinator, that is Dan Coast. He's responsible for the diploma program, which is grades 11 and 12. And then we have Alicia Miller, who is our middle years program. And again, for the community, not for people here, but the middle years program spans grades 6 through grades 10. So that's 5 grade levels of responsibility that the middle years program has, coordinator has. What we're finding is that the depth and complexity necessary to do the work within the middle years program is beyond the scope of one person. And if we're truly going to be an international baccalaureate school division that's premier, not only in the country but across the world, we need to provide the appropriate staff to be able to take care of the needs of the international baccalaureate program. It's particularly critical, I think, this coming year because we have a reauthorization coming up for our IB program. So our teams of teachers are reevaluating their units of study, they're going back, they're reworking some of the assessments, they're working through some of the curriculum and the like, and that takes leadership. And so this position would be a leadership type position, but based in the schools, working with our teachers. The second is our and we're proposing an English language arts pre-K coordinator. So you've heard me talk a number of times at the podium and elsewhere about our great Jen Fessenden, who is our pre-K-12 mathematics coordinator. This would be a tandem position to the position that currently Jen Fessenden is in. What we see in our data over time is we're seeing not a large decline, but a general decline, maybe a point a year in our reading, in our writing, and also in our language arts programs. And if you look at it from a state perspective, we had a presentation at VSBA this last year by James Lane. Dr. Lane is our state superintendent, and he showed that reading across the Commonwealth is beginning to decline in a much more precipitous rate than we are here in the city of Falls Church. But it's enough to give me pause and to think about what do we need to do to make sure that all of our teachers and our staff are prepared to support the students across the system in reading, language arts, and writing. So we believe that bringing somebody in that can work directly with teachers, talk about how to differentiate instruction, how to scaffold instruction, how to teach reading in combination of phonics and the like will really be helpful to the system. So we are proposing an English language arts pre-K-12 coordinator that would be system-wide, would work with our elementary, our middle, and our high school teachers around those areas of emphasis. The third is a social worker. We are proposing a 1.0 social worker. You may recall we proposed a psychologist in a previous budget, and so slowly but surely we're making gains on the work around making sure that our students have healthy climates and healthy environments to work in. And feel like they have a place to go. But this particular piece is helpful because it supports families as well. It's a more holistic approach to supporting the nature and needs of the students that we have in the system. So currently we have 2 part-time social workers, so we would anticipate that those 2 part-time employees would become full-time. However, that's something we anticipate. It might not be. It might be a whole nother person and 2 part-time people. But I just want to make sure that the board knows that the reason that we're requesting this additional social worker is to really meet some of the social emotional needs that we have across the system. And it gets to that caring community and culture that we speak to quite often. The next is some contract length adjustments and some revisions of some positions. So a couple examples that we really feel like we need to take care of to make the system right. And the first is, for example, Marie Baruti, our director of the preschool, currently is an 11-month employee, and she really needs to be a 12-month employee. And the reason she needs to be a 12-month employee is because we do extended school year programs at Jesse Thackeray, and she needs to be there for that and working with those students. Another employee who is a little misaligned is a middle school person who is running our Lighthouse program. He's a 10-month employee. Every summer we pay him hourly money to do an 11-month contract, and we just need to make his contract 11 months. So there are a few one-offs like that that we just need to figure out and right size, if you will, to make the system whole. The next thing, and we believe that that will really help us close gaps too, because they're going to be here in the summer working on professional development, working collaboratively to bring teachers and teams in, and working with families. The next is the Jesse Thackery office clinic support. Currently, we have a part-time person in that position, and we would really like that person to be full-time, to at least be there the whole day, because when that person leaves, Marie Baruti, who is the director of the preschool, ends up doing a lot of clerical tasks, routine clinic-type tasks, and quite frankly, I'm hopeful that she can be in classroom supervising instruction, and we know that that not only will support closing gaps, but also help us with our caring community and culture. And then the last is, with respect to caring community and culture, also is around custodial support. Nobody wants to work or learn in an environment that feels unfriendly and because of the physical area. We are adding 100,000 square feet to our new high school that will open in December. That requires 5 new custodial staff to take care of that building. This budget is representing 3 additional custodian positions, and we think that over the course of the next year we'll be able to manage and perhaps get the other 2 positions in next year's budget, because we won't open until December. But anyway, what you see here is the custodial support for the new high school. So those are the new expansion ideas that we really believe will help us achieve our goals, become investments in our future, and support those 3 big ideas of IB, caring community and culture, and closing gaps. So some of the reductions that we are taking, and again, these reductions are not at the cost of anyone. We will not be losing any employees as a consequence of these reductions. The first is salary lapse. This is savings that we achieve through people who are experienced that leave, and if we hire someone who is new, there is an offset between the amount that we were paying the more veteran person and the new person. Additionally, we have some teachers who might leave for part of the year, and it may take us a month or 2 to fill that position. That position then is filled through or is identified as a place for salary lapse. So we are looking at increasing our salary lapse by $59,000. So that's an additional amount of money that we're able to offset and help our budget balance. We're also looking at some other employee benefits. We are seeing within the retiree healthcare account a reduction of about $27,000. Our actuarial liability is coming down in that account, and we're very happy about that. The other savings that we're seeing with respect to retirees is we have had that transitional retiree program that you became familiar with, I think, last year. That was started in 2002, 2003 for people who are a minimum age of 45 and 5 years of satisfactory service. By July of 2002, had an opportunity to do some early retirement and get some pay. We're seeing fewer and fewer people that are part of that program, so the cost of the program is coming down by $44,000. And then the last reduction is about $31,000 projected decrease in FICA. There are a couple of things in here that I think are interesting points that I pointed out to a team of people yesterday that may be worthy of just sort of thinking about with respect to how we spend our money, because I think it goes to our genuine need for the positions that I just shared with respect to building the capacity in the people that we have. The first is that our step increase last year cost us about $1.3 million. This year, our step increase is going to cost us about $960,000. That's a decreased amount because the age of the, or not the age, but the experience of the employees that we have in the system has come down. So we don't have as many experienced employees as we've had in the past. So we're seeing the cost of that step being less than we anticipated. The other is this reduction in FICA speaks to that as well. We're seeing a reduction in FICA because we don't have as many salary-sensitive benefits. So the importance of professional development for us, I think, is something that we need to keep on our radar and pay attention to as we look at our horizon here in the City of Falls Church. We have a number of things that we are looking forward to potentially funding with one-time money if we receive additional allocation. Some of the things that we are looking at paying for out of one-time money are custodial support for George Mason High School. That really is a supply line more than it is people. So we're looking at additional supplies of about $21,000 out of one-time money. We have applied for 4 electric buses through the Dominion Electric process. We anticipate hearing as early as tomorrow what the outcome of that's going to be, but if we do receive those buses, we would be on the hook for $474,000. If we don't get those buses, we still will have a need for some replacement buses, so it's a good placeholder for us just in case we need some new buses. We are looking at facilities improvements at Henderson Middle School to the tune of about $200,000, and that would be to upgrade the front of the building to make a secure vestibule. Right now we have a closed and enclosed vestibule, but it would update that, bring the security person out into the vestibule, scan people there, and the like. And then the last is about a $3,000 one-time request that we would utilize for instructional supplies at Jesse Thackery Preschool. So one of the things I hope you've seen in this budget is some attention to Thackery. I think in the past few budgets, Thackery has not gotten necessarily everything that they've needed. And so in the budget tonight and the budget presentation that we've done, we would like to recognize some of the needs of JTP a little differently than they have been in the past. And I think that that's a real testament to the leadership of Marie Baruti, who's there serving in a role as an administrator and really identifying what some of those needs are with the staff. In every budget, there are unfunded needs and needs and wants. And so what you'll see here is an alphabetized list. These are not in any kind of rank order of the things that did not get included in the budget. One of the things that's good to know, I think, for the school board is when we took all of the requests that we got from the schools, from the principals, from committees and the like, and put them in into a pot and ran a spreadsheet on them, we had about $2 million in additional requests. Knowing that we had less than that to work with, we had to make some hard decisions. And through a good team process, we went through, we looked at how they aligned to the three big goals, and we were left with those things that landed above the line. And right now, these are the things that fall below the line. If some more money were to come in through a shared revenue process in the future with the general government, we would come back to this list, and we would work with our staff and our principals to prioritize these items that fell below the line and begin to pick those off as we could with the additional revenue. This is a cost per pupil slide shown in a slightly different way than it has in the past. And this shows, first, the top line is the Falls Church City cost per pupil over time. The bottom line is the CPI as adjusted in Falls Church City. And one of the things you'll see here is that there is almost a one-to-one correlation. So when we think about the school's budget as it relates to spending and inflation and the like across the rest of the city, it tracks almost identically to what's happening. So we are and continue to be, I think, within the meets and bounds of what an appropriate budget is, as well as continue to be extraordinarily effective and really efficient with the resources we have and maintaining those low class sizes. So one of the things that I always try to point out is that while our proposed cost per pupil, or our cost per pupil last year was $19,482, and our proposed cost per pupil next year will be just over $20,000, that number would come down in an extraordinary way if we staffed our schools differently than we do. I think everybody here understands that we staff our elementary schools 22 and 24 to 1, and our secondaries the same way. Most everybody else on this list is staffing their secondary schools at between 28 and 30 to 1. If we went to that ratio, our cost per pupil would go down in a way that would drop us probably to the middle of the pack. I don't recommend that. I think one of the things that we have in the city of Falls Church is we have really nice relationships with our students and our families, but it is an explanation for why our cost per pupil, comparative to other school systems, is relatively high. This is the summary budget. So on the left-hand side, again, you'll see the revenues. We've got state, federal, and local, which represent $54,594,282. On the right-hand side, you'll see the proposed budget expenditures. Here we have our STEP, our cost of living adjustment, the employer share of the health care increase, the Virginia retirement system, both the group life insurance and the retiree. costs, and then we have the investments in our goals and our future around the three big ideas: the IBMYP coordinator, English language arts coordinator, social worker, contract length adjustments, Jesse Thackeray clinic and office support, custodial support, and then some reductions in realignments. And you'll note this year those two numbers match: $54,594,282. And so we are completely balanced for the 2021 school year. Here's a budget calendar that we wanted to make sure that everybody has here, and the community does as well. Scrolling down to about the middle here, we're at January 14th. We've got a proposed budget presented tonight. Our first budget work session will be next Tuesday, and that's an opportunity for all of you to ask a lot of questions about the budget. From there, we will move into CIP and Planning Commission meetings, the city manager's budget presentation, and the evening that Chair Anderson will be presenting his budget is on March 9th. You will adopt the advertised budget on February 18th, and that's the budget then ultimately that will move over on March 9th to the city manager and the city council. And then on April 27th, the city council will make an adoption of their budget ordinance that would include the school transfer. And then we'll come back on May 5th, and any adjustments that need to be made to the budget, for example, if there's more revenue that fell out and how we would like to spend that going forward, that decision would be made together on May 5th. So just a little bit more information that I want to share with the board and with the community. All of our school board budget questions, we would respectfully request that those be submitted directly to me, the superintendent, and I will fan them out to the appropriate people on the staff so that we can get those answered in a timely fashion for the board. One of the things for our two new members this evening, we do catalog these questions as we get them by number so that we can reference them and reference back to them at any future point in time. In addition to that, we do review them at regular intervals. Typically, we do them at work sessions and do them by number. And then those responses will become part of our budget website that's going up on the FCCPS website. We're committed to being completely transparent throughout this process. One of the things we're going to acquaint you to this evening that I think is an extraordinary document is the budget book that you have this year that digs in very deeply into all of the things that we've talked about. And all of that, the budget book, the budget presentation this evening, any links to videos from tonight's presentation, any community meetings that are filmed as well, will all be available at the fccps.org. And if you put in keyword budget, that will get you right to all the materials and supplies you need to be able to make some good decisions about where we are with respect to the budget. So Chair Anderson and Vice Chair Russell, with that, I end my budget presentation this evening. I'm open to comments, potential questions, but I will say that primarily what we'd like to do is answer most of the questions in the work session and take those under advisement until we get there. Once you've completed any comments or questions that you have for me this evening, I will turn it over to Kristen Michael, our Chief Operating Officer, who will orient you to the budget book, because I think it will serve as an excellent resource for you through this budget process. So thank you for your time, and I welcome any thoughts, questions, and comments.
Thank you, Dr. Noonan, for a comprehensive presentation. So if there are initial comments, thoughts, questions for Dr. Noonan at this point from board members, I'd be happy to have those asked. But otherwise, as Dr. Noonan said, sending those in an email to Dr. Noonan so that he can collect them and distribute them appropriately and then route them back out to us and to the community, that would be great. So are there initial questions? Mr. Redinger.
So just I did send three questions to Dr. Noonan and Ms. Michael before. I did want to amplify one of them a little bit. So the three questions were around how we calculate the likely expenditures for salary and benefits and salary lapse in particular. The second one was what actually is included in the adjustment for contract length, because mm-hmm. there's been a lot of interest in among the support employees to making sure that we're adequately paying for the amount of time that we spend for our paras in particular. And the third around, you the budget includes two additional social workers. I'm interested, as I think a lot of other board members are, in making sure that we're going as quickly as we can to having the right ratio of psychologists, social workers, and counselors across all of the schools. And so I appreciate the addition of one FTE, maybe two half FTE, but I think that's a subject for further discussion. The thing that I wanted to expand upon and the additional request I wanted to make is, having seen your presentation now, I'm very interested, as I said, in the actual calculation around salaries and benefits, because over the long term, steps ought not cost anything, because unless your staff is getting more and more senior over time. So I gather that there's on any one year it may go up, but I'd like to understand when we say that the increase is about $971,000, if memory serves, for a step, whether that's above actuals or whether that's above the FY20 budget, and then how we calculated the lapse of $59,000 from that, because a lot of that is sort of right now murky to me. And since salaries and benefits are such a big part of what we do, that's a place I'd like to see data. The addition I'd make to the three written questions I submitted is I did not see in the budget book, and I appreciate that Ms. Michael is going to go through it right now, I see that on the school-by-school budgets that there are FY17 actuals, 18 actual, or FY17 budget actuals, FY18 actuals, FY19 actuals, where we are on FY20, and then the proposed budget for 21. What I'm really interested in seeing, not for all of those pieces, but for the big line item school-wide budgets, is what was the 19 budget? Sorry, what was the 18 budget? We're in 20 now, right? What was the 19 budget? What was the 19 actuals? What's the 20 budget? What's the 20 forecast? And what's the proposed 21 budget? So the idea being, how did we execute? Where were there? Where did we have extra resources or places we didn't execute last year? Where do we foresee that going this year? And then what are we predicting or proposing for next year? Because that's the thing that I would look at to figure out if we're budgeting properly and if we've got we're putting the resources in the right places. So that's just a general request. I don't expect an answer right now, but that's what I'd like to say.
Thank you for that. We appreciate those questions, the three in writing, and then we'll do our best to capture the fourth question that you've asked.
Thank you, Mr. Reitinger. Other questions? Mr. Webb?
Question I have, and then we can talk about it at the work session. It's more about the social worker piece. Down in Richmond yesterday at the VSBA Legislative Conference, the governor mentioned about some additional funding that's coming within that area to try to bring that ratio up. Is that some of the additional funding that you were talking about that we're potentially coming into that's going to help us be able to afford and move? We already have the ratios, but actually to afford to pay for additional social workers within the district.
The additional money that we're receiving from the state is going to help us pay for that additional social worker. The vast majority of the compensation, if you wanted to bifurcate the budget a little bit, you could look at the general government's transfer pays for salary and benefits, and the state transfer pays for the additional pieces of social worker, English language arts, etc. So yes, the additional funding that we're receiving from the state does afford us an opportunity to increase our social worker by 1.0. One of the things that Michelle Kopic has been looking at and working with her colleagues across the region is looking at what are the ratios of social workers and how do we fall within those ratios. And so as we gather that data, we can share that information as well at the work session so you can see exactly what is our ratio currently and what would it be if we got the additional social worker.
Any other burning comments and questions right now, otherwise? OK,
Okay.
Thank you. Thank you, Dr. Noonan. Ms. Michael is now going to walk us through the budget book.
Yeah, and I'm going to resume my seat up front. I just want to, again, thank you all for your time and attention this evening, and look forward to working with you over the next month and a half to get to that point where we adopt the proposed budget, or the adopted budget by the school board. So thank you.
Thank you very much, Dr. Noonan.
So thank you. After tonight's meeting, John Brett, thank you, John, and our communications department is going to post a number of items on the website for the community to access. The first is we are posting Excel files of all of the data that we've included in terms of the charts for each of the different funds. So you'll find all of the Excel charts for the school operating fund as well as the community services and food service fund. In addition to that, tonight, based on feedback from the board, we've also included what we're calling budget at a glance, which is a front and a backside sheet. We've put it in the left-hand pocket of your binders. That really is kind of that high-level overview for the community of a little bit of the budget in one page, a front and a back. So the front is really the narrative part of the letter from the superintendent, and the back part of that document includes the summary financial charts, some information on enrollment and our cost per pupil, and then our revenue and expenditure pie charts and links to the budgets. We hope that one-page budget at a glance will really help the community. In terms of the budget document that we prepared tonight, our goal is always continuous improvement and try to respond to the feedback that we've received. So I would just like to walk through that document and point out the new things that both you and the community can find in that book. When it's published online, you'll find at the very beginning a table of contents. That table of contents hopefully will help orient everyone to the information included in the packet. Our first chapter is really the introduction. It includes the letter from the superintendent, as well as the presentation that Dr. Noonan gave to the board this evening. Section 2 is our goal, so that's our placemat and our triennial plan. And then when we look at Section 3 about FCCPS, this is a section that we've really worked to enhance. So the first thing that you'll notice that's new is we've included a basic about Falls Church City Public Schools kind of fact sheet on page 73. It tells a little bit about our mission, our schools, our students' ethnicities, graduates, SAT scores. And then following that, with some great help from Mary Beth Conley and our principals, we actually have written descriptions from each of our schools. So a really nice overview of each of the individual schools that was added. And when we look at Section 4 is enrollment. This year, in addition to the enrollment information that we've presented previously, you'll find on pages 88 and 89 that we have a much longer historical view of enrollment. So we have a chart that actually goes back to 1986 in terms of enrollment, in addition to the wonderful bar chart that Dr. Noonan presented tonight that Michelle Kopic developed. Also included in the enrollment section, we've put the FCPS student by dwelling unit information. So looking at that, that's also included in the budget document. When we move to Section 5, that's our 2021 budget highlights. So it has information about each of the new items that Dr. Noonan went over this evening. Section 6 is our operating fund, so it talks more about our revenue in the operating fund for 2021, as well as our expenditures. And that's where you'll find our school operating fund statement, as well as revenue and expenditures by object or by type. Section 7 is our other funds, so community services, food service fund, and our capital improvements. And then in Section 8 is our appendix. So we've also made some enhancements here that I hope are very helpful to the board and the community. The first is when we get to page 171, we had previously shared with the board and the community what our school planning factors were. So what are our formulas or our ratios in terms of positions like principal, classroom teacher? The enhancement that we made this year is we've added a state that shows what the state accreditation standards are. So it shows, you know, how many principals do you need per school or how many teachers. So after the elementary school planning factors, another thing that we've added this year that is new and that we hope is helpful begins on page 178. And those are staffing charts where we've indicated for each school how many positions do they have. And we've given you their actual staffing for fiscal year 19-20 and what the proposed staffing would be for next year, as well as the change. And then following that, in the same section, after the salary scales, one of the other things we've really separated and tried to highlight this year is our tuition rates and student fees, which you can find on page 197. They typically in the past had been kind of blended into our miscellaneous pay rates, so we really tried to separate them out to increase that transparency. Continuing in the rest of this chapter are all of the additional financial charts. Those are the Excel files that are available online. We also have a section for board members as you work through this budget process in Section 9 for you to keep your budget questions and answers as we publish them. And for your reference and the community, the prior year budget questions and responses are on our website. Section 10 will allow you to have prior budget work session material for the board's reference. We included information on student achievement as well as enrollment and budget in this binder for your reference. And then we also have a section for presentations from the general government, which includes the fiscal forecast that they shared with us. So we really hope that this enhanced budget document is useful to both you and the community, and we really do look forward to your continued feedback on how we can continue to make this better.
I'd like to, if I may, just take a second to again thank Michelle Kopic and Kristen Michael, Ms. Michael, for doing this. One of the things they've made a commitment to, and I hope you'll see it in this, is every year have materials that are better than the year before. And so I think that this year begins to really get at some of these pieces that I think our community's been asking for, and again speaks to our transparent nature of a budget.
Thank you, Ms. Michael, and thank you, Dr. Noonan. Any comments, questions, quickly, just to help with organization and understanding our budget books? Hearing none, I'll just take the moment to say thank you. I already saw some things in here that I definitely recognize as improvements from last year that were in response to questions that I know came from members last year. So thank you very much for the work that went into this. It's clear there's been a lot. So thank you. All right. If there are no other comments or questions on this item, we can go ahead and move on down to item 9.02, which will begin our discussion of policies. And I would like to turn this over to Ms. Minson, please.
Good evening. We have two policies for second reading this evening. The first is policy BCD, close meetings. This is the policy that would replace current bylaw 2.26 on closed meetings. Based on what's posted on the board, on board docs right now, there would be no changes from first reading, except I notice there's no period following paragraph A on line 5 on page 1, and no paragraph following paragraph B at page 86 on page 3. So I can make those changes. Any questions, comments, concerns with policy BCD, closed meetings?
Mr. Redinger.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. I mentioned to Ms. Minson just before the meeting, I didn't have a chance to go through and read these policies until today, and I was not present for the first reading of this policy. I have a suggestion to shorten this policy, which I am not hard over on, but it just seems to me that most of this policy, the numbered paragraphs under A, are nothing but a cut and paste from a statute. And a statute that changes not infrequently. And I simply wonder whether all of those numbered paragraphs through item 15 could be deleted, and instead A could say something along the lines of, closed meetings may be held by the school board or any committee thereof only in accordance with Virginia law, comma, as specified in, and then a cross-reference to the statute, mm-hmm. rather than repeating all of this. I can see some value in including this because it means that people don't need to go to look at the statute, but the statute is publicly available, and it feels like a lot of language that really isn't all that necessary and frankly isn't of much interest to most people. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Redinger. Are there is any feedback on that idea? It's not, I don't know how formal yet we are, but is there any feedback on that concept? Ms. Russell.
I think that it makes sense, just, you know, assuming what Phil's saying is correct in terms of the frequency of the changes, it would cut down on needing to do frequent revisions to our policy if we were just to reference whatever is currently on the code.
And the Virginia Code section that would be referenced is the one that's on page 3 at line 106, 2.2, 3711.
And in after you raised this, Mr. Redinger, I went back and looked at that code section, and the language from today is slightly different than what's included in the VSBA model policy. So that would support kind of your approach to this. I do know that one of our current policies on teacher grievances specifically says that the school board will follow the teacher grievance process as outlined in Virginia code, and then references to the Virginia administrative code there. So that would be consistent with what we've done in other types of time. At the same time, the VSBA, when they do, we subscribe to their policy services, they do update all the policies. So if this policy were updated in the future, we would just make sure that we follow the VSBA model update. So I think it's really six of one, half dozen of another, and whatever the board's preference is there.
Ms. Minson, I guess just a procedural question. If we were to, if there were a motion made along those lines and we were to adopt it, then would we need to sort of cancel, not complete second reading, but have a second reading at our next meeting in February, or could we take some other course?
We could go forward with the motion, policy BCD, closed meetings as amended, and I would just need to make sure that I'm clear on what you want the language to be starting at line six, or we could move this to third reading, and I could present a cleaned up version of it at the meeting in February if everyone wants to lay eyes on another time. That's not atypical, and that's not a problem for me to do. So then just from the dais, the motion would just be for the second reading and adoption, approve second reading of BCD, and then second reading and adoption, assuming you all are okay with policy BCDA.
Mr. Redinger, do you have a suggestion for this or a preference for this?
Just to save time, I think the proposal is relatively straightforward, so I would suggest that it simply say that the change be in line six, in accordance with Virginia law, and then a cross-reference to the specific section, and then a period, and then remove all of the numbered subparagraphs. Mm-hmm. And I think it's fairly simple and straightforward to do that without going to third reading.
So we would keep it, closed meetings may be held by the school board or any committee thereof only in accordance with Virginia law, comma, specifically Virginia Code 2.23711?
Yes.
Period. Great. Does that sound amenable to the rest of the board?
Any other comments on this? Okay, so we'll make the appropriate motions after we've had the discussion for BDCA then.
Okay, and then lines B, C, and D starting on page 3 would remain the same. So it's just getting rid of paragraphs numbered 1 through 15.
15, yes.
Great. All right, moving on to the next policy for second reading, BCDA. This is calling and certification of closed meetings. It very closely aligns with FCCPS bylaw 2.27. There was one proposed change from first reading, which changing the language back to no closed meetings shall be held rather than are held by. Any questions about policy BDCA?
Any questions? Not seeing any. Okay. Then I would entertain a motion with the appropriate amendment from what is online. Mr. Redinger.
I'll give it a shot. I move that the school board approve second reading and adoption of the following policies. Policy BCD, closed meetings, as amended, and policy BDCA, calling and certification of closed meetings.
Thank you, Mr. Redinger. Is there a second?
Second.
Mr. Webb, thank you. Ms. Goodell, do we need to do a roll call vote, or can we just do
unanimous?
All right, then. All those in favor, please say aye.
Yes.
Aye. Any abstentions or objections? Okay. Thank you. Moving on to 9.03, which, again, I will turn to Ms. Minson.
Thank you. This is slightly different than what we usually do. Policy FEA had been previously adopted by the board on June 12, 2018. There were changes to the House Bill 1725, proposed changes that are now reflected in the Virginia Code at 22.1138C, which is shown on this policy at lines 23 to 26. saying that in the educational facility specifications, school boards will consult with local building officials and state or local fire marshals to make sure that all security enhancements to public school buildings are compliant with uniform statewide building code and statewide fire prevention codes. I've proposed, if the board is amenable to it, waiving first reading, since this is just a change to make sure that we're compliant with the Virginia code. It's something that we already do. It won't change our practices, but amending the policy by waiving first reading and going to second reading and adoption by adding this language would allow us to be consistent with the Virginia code. Any questions on policy FEA or the proposal to waive first reading?
Any comments or questions? Seeing no comments or questions, then I would entertain a motion on this one. Mr. Webb?
Mr. Chair, I move that the school board move to waive second reading and adopt policy FEA as presented.
Thank you, Mr. Webb. Is there a second?
Second.
Thank you, Ms. Litton. All those in favor, say aye.
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 Any abstentions or opposition? All right, seeing none, motion carries. Moving on to 9.04, adoption of first reading of policies. Again, Ms. Minson.
Great, we have two policies for first reading this evening. The first is policy BDA, regular school board meetings. This would replace FCCPS bylaw 2.23. 2.23 had previously covered both regular school board meetings and electronic participation in meetings from remote locations. The remote locations portion was already covered in the board's adoption of BDD on December 11, 2018. So adopting regular school board meetings, BDA would allow us to completely get rid of bylaw 2.23. In comparing BDA to bylaw 2.23, the language is substantially similar in virtually every way to what the bylaw says. So this would not change any of our practices. And I don't propose any changes to the VSBA model policy, BDA. Any questions on this policy?
Not seeing any.
All
Thanks.
Right. So the last policy for tonight is policy BDDH, public participation at school board meetings. You will note that I have made a few proposed changes to this policy. Some of the strike-throughs show that instead of saying chairman and him, it is a neutral and I'm talking about the speaker rather than the gendered person who is addressing the school board. One thing that the VSBA has been doing recently in its policy adoption, and I've spoken with Elizabeth Ewing at the VSBA about this, is if something is not expressly required by the Virginia Code, they're removing it from policy and allowing it to be part of regulation. While I understand that practice, I think it's challenging here. Because the language that the school board proposed is that the school board adopt this policy and then adopt a regulation that talks about the length of community participation in school board meetings. And we've tried to keep the regulation process something that the superintendent proposes, adopts, and puts forward so that if there need to be necessary changes over time, the superintendent can make quicker changes to regulations, and that policy is in the province of the board. Our current policy 2.30, which would be replaced by BDDH, explicitly states that each speaker's presentation is limited to 3 minutes. So I proposed adding that at line 24 here. And our current policy also asks that the speaker state their name, address, and the subject of their remarks. I think that makes it clear to the board who's presenting and what they're presenting on, whether it is that they're a citizen of Falls Church City or they're a teacher or they have another connection to the school division. So I did bring that over, but otherwise BDDH, besides those changes that I've pointed out and that are reflected in the red line version here, is quite similar to our current bylaw 2.30. Any questions about BDDH?
I'm not seeing any, but I actually did have two questions on this one, and I think one of them is in the stretch between lines 14 and 18.
Yes.
It's just because of the changes in the strike-throughs, all of which I agree completely with, but the sentence that ends with "the speaker shall address the chair," the next sentence now says, "at the conclusion of the speaker's remarks, any member of the school board desires further information, the member will address the speaker only." there should
it's missing
there's
it.
A there's a there's something yeah. missing in there, and that's all, just if that yeah. one gets
at the
fixed.
Conclusion of the speaker's remarks, if any member of the school board desires future information, the member addresses the speaker. Okay, I will add that in.
Okay. The more substantive question really is that limitation of 3 minutes. Is that something that we really, I don't know, I'm sort of asking fellow members, but also is it wise to have that in the policy? Because if for whatever reason the chair were to decide it was 2 minutes because we've got 50 people in the room, or you know, somebody needed one extra minute, or for whatever reason the board wanted to extend it in a given circumstance, we'd be... I guess we'd have to have a specific action to waive that policy that day. So I just don't know what people think about whether we want to put the limit in there or whether we want to not. So knowing that it is in the current policy. Ms. Lynn.
I actually think it's good to have the limit in there so that when folks go to our policies, they see that we're enforcing the policy. And then if we need to, we can waive it. Otherwise, I think people may feel that we are controlling, you know, how much, if it's an issue we disagree with, maybe we would be giving them less time versus we can refer to, it's clearly in the policy unless we state a clear reason not to do it that way. So I actually would support keeping it in there.
Mr. Webb.
I would support that as well. And I think what we've done in the past, I know I have, it's when folks are giving their presentation within that 3 minutes that you do kind of, we have been somewhat flexible to give an extra 30-second or minute here and there for folks to kind of finish up their thoughts and that, you know, but we do, you know, at a point we will kind of have to rein it back, but I do think it's good to have it in there that says 3 minutes. But I think it's to the discretion of the chair potentially to give an extra 30 seconds or something like that to finish up a thought.
Thank you to both of you. Any other thoughts on this, Mr. Redding?
So just one thing to think about. I agree with both Ms. Litton and Mr. Webb. I think the policy ought to say specifically 3 minutes. I do think there ought to be discretion in the chair to waive that in particular cases. And I'm thinking about one, Mr. Webb would remember this, one discussion we had where a very senior and soon to retire school employee was not able to complete her remarks because they were going to last longer than 3 minutes. And it was extremely uncomfortable for everyone, the chair in particular, who had to enforce the policy. And so I would support... in keeping the 3 minute limitation, but either have an understanding that the chair can waive that with general consent of the board, or include a specific exception unless the time is extended at the discretion of the chair.
I would agree with that. I know exactly the situation that Phil is referring to, and it was did not put the school board in a good light, I didn't think. So I think to have some sort of standard but some flexibility is a good thing.
So I'm certainly persuaded by then having the limits. You've all made really good arguments. The question is whether or not there needs to be language putting in that discretion in some way to make it more clear, to sort of build on that same thought that it is in the policy, we're just following the policy, or whether we think that's necessary. And if folks think it is, then if somebody wants to suggest some language for it.
I'd respectfully suggest that there not be a discretionary extension in writing because then it couldn't be a content-neutral decision as to whether or not we're impacting someone's ability to express an opinion that the board may agree or disagree with. I think in practice it's something that can be done out of deference to who the speaker is or what's going on, but it's better not to have that in writing. I'm recalling a school board meeting where there was a young student who was reading and who needed a little bit more time to get through that. So I think no one is going to call the board out on allowing a child a few more moments to finish reciting something or to get over nerves or other things, but I don't think that there needs to be anything expressly in writing that would allow the chair to extend it.
Okay, I'm seeing lots of nods around the table then to take that and include line 24 as presented, but then fix the missing if sort of in that middle section and therefore 4. Are there any other comments on this one? If not, I would entertain a motion for these two policies.
I move that the school board approve first reading of the following policies: BDA, regular school board meetings; BDDH, also policy KD, public participation at school board meetings.
Thank you, Ms. Linton. Is there a second?
Second.
Thank you, Ms. Downs. All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Any abstention or objection? All right, seeing none, the motion passes. And we are now on to 10.01, future agenda items. Does anyone have any future agenda items that they want to bring up at this point? Ms. Russell.
I think I've mentioned this in the past, but I definitely would like to revisit the topic of Jillian Williams' diversity study. And I guess specifically, one of his recommendations was a board action item that I think that we need to look at in terms of developing. I can't remember if it was a specific policy or if it was a statement, but something along those lines, and revisiting his report and the action item specific to the board.
Okay, thanks. Mr. Webb.
And I wasn't going to make that comment, but since Ms. Russell did, I was actually thinking the same thing. I was like, I've mentioned it before, so I'll just kind of wait until it comes up. But I echo that. Would like to, at some point in the near future, begin that looking at and taking a dive and see what action items that we can potentially take on from his report.
Mr. Reitinger.
So I'm going to be a little less shy. I've got 4, but one of them has already been mentioned. I agree with both Mr. Webb and Ms. Russell that it's time for us to return to the diversity inclusion report. My particular interest is, I think it's going to be hard for the superintendent and the school staff to make as much progress as they could until we talk about what our objective really ought to be. What are we trying to achieve? What does diversity and inclusion look like to us? And I think that is a clear board level decision that would inform and enable a lot of action. So I would strongly support discussing that. The other ones, which I'm going to raise now, some of which I raised before, but I think since we're starting a new board term, I'd like to throw out there. We have in the documents distributed for the board to look at today the chart of school population growth by different units. And it is very interesting. For example, you know, we've always seen in the past that our enrollment can vary heavily based on what happened. It used to be Oakwood and now Falls Green. And this year, our enrollment did not go more because it dropped by 38, which is the biggest drop. In fact, that's a bigger shift even than from single family homes. I think we ought to, because changes in population matter so much to us, and with the changing demographics that we've got around people for whom English is not an original language and economically disadvantaged students, I think it's important for the board at some point in the rhythm of our normal work to look at the demographics, what's changing in our population base, and what's changing, and why it's changing, because you know, we've had some variability from the Weldon Cooper numbers lately, and I think maybe if we work to understand what that is, you know, and I mentioned before, I'd love to bring in some realtors to talk to us about what they're seeing in terms of people moving into the city, because they probably, you know, got a better finger on a lot of what's happening than anybody else does. The third thing I wanted to mention is the general subject of technology. And there's both the overall question of use of technology in the schools, and I believe it was not last year, but the year before, or maybe it was last year, we re-upped the contract for all of the Apple devices. One of the things that we discovered when we did that is it's hard to make a choice about which technology to use in the course of a budget discussion. And there's a larger overall concern about, are we have we found the sweet spot with regard to use of technology in our schools? Do we have too much screen time, not enough screen time? And I think that's a, you know, given that we are such a technology-driven school system, that's something I would like to see the board turn to, not in a budget cycle, but in an actual course of a meeting. The last thing, sorry to throw out so many, I'd like to, perhaps personally, I'd like to return to the subject of standards-based grading. We had a work session on it earlier in the year that was very informative, had a number of school staff members come in and talk about the plans. I would like to hear a little bit more about what the experience has been and what the reality is. And I'll be very frank, I have now experienced standards-based grading as a parent, and I am probably more confused than I thought I would be. And I don't have yet the sense that standards-based grading is achieving, you know, it sounds great in theory. I just want to make sure that we're actually having improved grading and consistent grading and understandable grading, as opposed to something that's really confusing parents and not giving students good feedback. And that to me is less of a bringing in of people to explain standards-based grading to us, and more an examination of how it's actually working in the classroom, and from students who may support it and not support it, teachers who may support it and not support it. I'd be very interested in seeing a broad view of, because my mind is by no means made up, I want to see what the data is. So that's my set of four, and I apologize for talking so long.
Thank you, Mr. Reitinger. I definitely am hearing agreement on the first one of your four as being the same as theirs. Are there other comments about any of these others? Ms. Russell?
I guess I would agree with Phil with regard to number four specifically, that I would like to have a check-in on standards-based grading and just, I guess, more data in terms of how things are going, how the teachers are feeling about it, how the students are feeling about it. And I guess this is a little off topic, but it's just directed at Dr. Noonan. They're having standard-based grading sessions this week to explain it, and I guess my understanding is that it's requesting that people bring in a computer to basically follow along with regard to Schoology and PowerSchool and walking through that intricacy. And I would just make the request that if we could look into potentially offering that as some sort of webinar or as a recorded that somebody, you know, people could watch at a future point in time, because at least the description of it sounds like it would be very valuable, because I know as a parent, I look at Schoology, and I say, I have no clue what's going on in here now. And I think it would be very helpful, but I know that there's going to be a number of parents who are not able to make those sessions. One of them is this evening, so obviously none of us are able to attend. And then the other one, I think, is on Thursday morning, like at 8:30, which some parents. So I just think that if we were able to even offer a webinar where people could follow along at home, that would be hugely helpful too, especially for the people who don't have computers that they can bring in to these sessions to follow along.
Thank you, Ms. Russell. Other comments? Mr. Webb.
I also wanted to definitely hear a little bit about the standards-based learning as well. And it's comes from two folds for me of what we're doing, but then also where I went to high school at, and I'm on the board there. They're working to do something very similar to what we're doing. So I'd be very interested to kind of hear how the experience has been with our students and staff as they make that transition, because of what's going on here, I hear the exact same thing that they're trying to, students as well as parents are trying to understand exactly how, and for all intents and purposes, how colleges are going to look at that particular area. So I'd be interested to hear a little bit more about how the implementation has been going as well.
Okay, thanks. Any other future agenda items? Otherwise, I'll try to summarize what I think I've heard. Ms. Downs.
Hi, I have two suggestions. The first would be putting on the agenda a way that the school board could communicate more effectively to the community as to what we're doing. I think
I had mentioned before that Arlington Public Schools, no, granted they're a bigger school system, but their school board releases a biweekly or a regular newsletter. So investigating, you know, when I was campaigning, I think a lot of people were ill-informed as to what we do in our role of governance versus running schools. So I think that would be great for us and great for the community. The second is looking at moving up the calendar. So working on the calendar earlier in the year so that we're not at in December talking about the calendar, but doing it more as trying to get it maybe even by the end of the fiscal year so that that families can plan ahead.
Okay. All right. Any other last ones? Otherwise, I'll try to summarize. So I'm hearing, and I'll simply say I'm in agreement with completely with the diversity report with the standard-based grading. I was intending to bring up the community communications idea at our retreat because I think it is something that we should talk about. So I'm totally in alignment with that. So I'm hearing I've now got 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 items on here, and I'm seeing at least 3 that have multiple folks support, so maybe we should start with those for scheduling up in upcoming work sessions. And Dr. Noonan, I'll be happy to sit down and figure out a timing with you on that one, and then pick up the others as well at a future conversation. So, does that sound fair to everyone? All right, I'm seeing nods. All right, thank you very much for that. We'll now move on to our superintendent's report and Dr. Noonan.
Great, thank you very much. First of all, let me respond quickly to these items that you've all asked for more information on. These are not things that we're not paying attention to, so we'd be happy to talk with all of you about some of these things. It's just a matter of scheduling them out and getting them on those work sessions, so we look forward to that. The first update, I'll just go school by school. Jesse Thackeray, the lottery for tuition-paying students, is open through the end of the month as part of the preschool program. And this part of the preschool program is key to ensuring that we have a balanced population of students, and we're hoping for a robust response. So there'll be an open house for any of our interested families January 22nd in the evening, and hope that folks will come out. At Mount Daniel, we have a really great new partnership with Rex and Park. In response to parents' requests for early release Wednesday-only childcare, Rex and Park is helping us in the afternoon with some programmings, and parents can sign up through Rex and Park's website for the new offering at Mount Daniel for aftercare on early release Wednesdays. And that was sort of a good outcome of some of the conversations that we had here. The elementary give day, and this is for TJ, is Monday, January 20th on Martin Luther King Day. We are very proud of our fifth grade give day ambassadors who are visiting classrooms at TJ and Mount Daniel to get younger students involved in our annual give day. They're collecting household items for home stretch and food donations to make power packs for distribution regionally through Food for Others. And the blood mobile will also be on site that day, so if you're interested in giving blood. At Henderson, and hashtag singing together and hashtag playing together, the chorus held its winter concert last week, and it was really great to see so many students excited about singing together. Last night, the band concert was held in 3 parts. Both the chorus and the band concerts were in the auditorium at George Mason for the first time. And I just want to commend the high school and the middle school for working so well together around that space. We did have the musical there last year from Henderson as well, and will again this year. And they really, it was important because they helped accommodate such large audiences. Through the grant of the Falls Church Education Foundation, phase 1 of 3 of Henderson's new Ninja Room is open and underway. There's transformations happening in the auxiliary gym. And that rock wall that was built in 2005, really turning it into a state-of-the-art Ninja Warrior training facility for 665 middle school special needs students at MEH George Mason, staff, students, and students enrolled in our ASAP program and the like. If you haven't seen the pictures that have been up on Twitter and a couple other places, they're really great. Kids are swinging and hanging from all kinds of different things in a really safe environment, too, which is important. At George Mason, the first career shadowing day for seniors will take place on January 27th. We're still in need of some job sites for students who would visit for 3 or 4 hours. So if people are interested in signing up, there is a link on our website. So if you wouldn't mind going to our website or calling Mary Beth Connolly, that would be great. And then tomorrow is course selection at George Mason High School for next year. So we're already in the planning phases for what courses students will take next year and learning about some of those opportunities. Falls Church Ed Foundation, just a year-end push for donations to the Family Assistance Fund, exceeded $20,000. The foundation just continues to do extraordinary work, which funds many of our social workers' efforts to help families with food, clothing, school supplies, and more. I'm particularly grateful that the Ed Foundation has taken this on. When we think about closing gaps and creating a caring community and climate, it certainly has supported that in an amazing way. And it's allowed our school staff to focus on direct services to students while our professional fundraisers take care of some of the other stuff. And then in community, on Monday the 4th, Martin Luther King Day, there will be a march and commemoration program taking place in Falls Church. The program is a great opportunity for education and participation, and I hope all of you will attend. It begins at 9 o'clock at the Tinner Hill Arch, and the route will take marchers down Route 29 to the Falls Church for a program there. So with that, Chair Anderson, I will wrap up my superintendent remarks.
Thank you, Dr. Noonan. Are there any questions for Dr. Noonan? All right. Thanks very much. Mm-hmm. Moving on then to 12.01, Board and Student Liaison Comments, and I will look over at our student member to see, Ms. Singvi, do you have anything you want to tell us about? Okay. Ms. Dimmick.
So I've not extricated myself from the Health and Wellness Committee yet, but will in another 10 days or so, but wanted to let you know that we have raised funds to do a film series. So our plan is to show the first film on the 26th of this month. It's Finding Kind. It's about girl-on-girl bullying. We also plan to show Like, about social media, and Principal Hardy is interested in showing that at Henderson on an early release, after school before the late bus, so students could go and then still catch the late bus. And the other movies are The Upstanders, which is about bullying, and Angst, which is about anxiety. So, and we have funds to do one community showing and one in-school showing if a school wants, or I think we can do two community showings within 48 hours. So, thanks.
Thanks. Mr. Webb?
Thank you, Mr. Anderson. I'll give a little report from the athletic boosters. I was unable to go to that meeting on Monday night because I was down in Richmond for the legislative conference, but got some information they wanted to share. They are hosting two youth basketball nights for the girls and boys team on Friday, January 24th. It will be for the guys game, and on Friday, January 31st for the girls game. They plan to have a lot of giveaways for some of the youngest fans, and they're hoping for big crowds. And it's just a way that they're looking at to connect with some of the younger students in CCPS. They are also focusing on the annual March Madness fundraiser on Saturday, March 28th. It is their biggest fundraiser of the year, which they raise approximately between $8,000 to $10,000 for their use during the year, which we as a board and our athletics departments do benefit from those funds that are raised. So we definitely, folks who need some mulch, make sure you reach out to them and get a couple bags shipped over to your house. And that is it for my comments. Went down with Ms. Litton, and I took part in the annual legislative day. We talked with today. I was over today and met with our legislative delegation, talking about our package, and also it was good to see. It's a opportunity that we've not had in years, that hopefully, fingers crossed, that we already got a little bit of extra money from the state, where it's a rarity that we get anything from Richmond. So it's already gotten off to a much better start than what we normally expect. Only hopefully it'll get a little bit better as time goes on. Thanks.
Thank you, Mr. Webb. Ms. Lynn?
I don't have much to add. None of my committees have met, but yeah, joined Mr. Webb yesterday down at the legislative conference. You know, and I think generally people are feeling very positive because it looks like significantly more money. But you know, they did raise a few issues that they think will pop up due to the change in leadership that could actually be negatives for school boards. So, you know, I think there may be some different issues this year that we'll be alerted to. So we'll keep everybody up to date on what's happening and whether we need involvement from the board.
Thank you, Ms. Linton. Ms. Russell?
So the only, I guess, addition I have from Dr. Noonan's comments, because he covered the career shadowing for BIE, was with regard to the foundation. They have their gala coming up in May, and I believe the theme is Roaring Twenties. And then the other thing is the foundation is actually kind of going through, I guess, some reorganization. They're just looking at kind of, I guess, reorganization and government restructuring. So that's what they're looking at right now, and that's kind of where their focus is. And then I guess the other thing is just to make everyone aware that it's that time of year where we start reshuffling the liaison assignments. And so you'll be receiving an email from, I don't know, Ms. Goodell, regarding the lovely array of liaison assignment options. And hopefully we will also be able to provide the dates or days, I guess, the schedule of meetings, so you don't end up like Shauna Russell and have all your meetings stacked in the same week. so that would be a piece of advice for you, is to actually look at the schedule. And then also, of course, feel free to reach out to the current liaisons or people who've performed the roles in the past if you're interested in more information about the different committees and what they do and what the expectations are. So,
Ms. Russell, Mr. Redinger.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Only one of my liaison groups has met this year, and that was the ESOL LEAP committee. I unfortunately got the word that the meeting had been canceled after I was at the central office, so that did not take place, but I'll be attending future meetings. I did want to raise the performance that took place last night that Dr. Noonan referred to at Creative Cauldron. So for those of you who were not able to attend, it was a play written by Mr. Northrup and performed by four George Mason students with technical assistance from another. It's amazing to see the level of talent our students have and the work that's done by our faculty as well. So if you have opportunities to do that sort of thing in the future, it's always worth going to, you know, the George Mason fall and spring productions and the MEH productions as well. The last thing I just wanted to briefly mention, it goes back to the budget discussion, and this is for the chair and vice chair to consider, whether we are going to do school board visits to schools as a part of the process, because if we want to do that, the time will be on us very rapidly, and those can be somewhat difficult to schedule. So I just would work to not let too much time pass before we take a look at that. That's it for me. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Redinger. Ms. Downs. Okay. I'll say none of my committees have met since we last met, but I want to just highlight three things for everyone. Dr. Noonan already alluded to the day of service on January 20th, and I'd encourage everyone who can to go to the event and participate in the march and listen in and learn. The City Council is having a retreat on Saturday, 25th of January. I'm not sure of the location yet, but timing starts at 9 a.m. and it goes through part of the day. It's a little bit weird with the other event that's scheduled that day, but I'm not sure what they're going to do. I don't know, Dr. Neufeld.
I have a little bit of information, Mr. Chair, and that is only to say that we are trying to schedule. We aren't trying to schedule. They are trying to schedule their retreat at Mary Ellen Henderson.
Okay.
In the Media Center. And that way, at 10 o'clock, they could take a break and join us for our hard hat tour.
Okay, thank you very much for that. And then a reminder that we will be having our retreat on February 6th, which is Thursday, over at the, what's it going to be, the Hilton Garden Inn, right? And we'll be, the whole point of this is an opportunity for us as the new board to come together and discuss how we're going to work together, what are the strategic goals that we have for the coming year. This would be a really good opportunity. I was going to bring up this communication with the community at that point, but agenda to follow. I did have a chance to talk with everyone over the previous last few weeks about kind of topics that folks would like to do. I'll be using that as a starting point with an agenda, and Dr. Noonan and I will be reaching out with more details in the coming days. So looking forward to having everybody there to the extent that that's possible, and we'll go forward into our year together. And that's all I have to say. So unless there are any other comments from the board, we'll keep going. All right. We don't have any minutes to approve this time, and there are some materials for board review. Enrollment information is also in the budget book, but the student ratios per dwelling unit, which I looked at myself over the weekend, I also see some really interesting things in there as well as the ones Phil mentioned. And then there is a list of events for school board representation coming up. Encourage us to make sure we can be there when possible. Mr. Redding?
I just wanted to, especially for the two new board members, to highly recommend the detailed review of the student ratios by dwelling unit, which goes back many years and shows the changes in demographics and where kids come from. If you haven't looked at that before, it's very instructive and very useful.
And it actually addresses several common questions we'll hear, no doubt, over the coming weeks. So thank you. And if there is nothing else from anyone, then we will be adjourned.